यस यू कैन स्टार्ट परण जी, डॉक्टर परण गौड़ा जी, नमस्ते।
थैंक यू। See, this is the part two of the topic on Indian culture, which is related to philosophy, artificial intelligence, yoga. The preliminaries, we have discussed this in the part one. Now, in continuation of that, we will go to part two, which we mainly discuss about the quantum consciousness. How quantum consciousness is related to Indian culture and how it is related to artificial intelligence and how it is related to the present day robotics, which we call it as smart devices, or it can be called as Internet of Things. So basically, by knowing quantum consciousness, the other things can easily be derived. Before going into what is quantum consciousness, we should understand the meaning of the words quantum and consciousness. We will start with the layman's meanings of these two words, and then gradually we will enter into the highly technical and scientific way of looking at quantum consciousness. But we will start with simple meanings. Now, what is quantum? Any scale which has smaller dimensions of the nanometer size and lesser than the nanometer, the lesser than the nanometer scale, it can go up to 10 to power of minus 38, which we call it as Planck's constant. Under these ranges, we cover all the subtle things, atom, nucleus, proton, quarks, electrons, all this will be covered in the quantum scale. Now, there is another scale, which we call it as a Newton's scale or classical scale. Classical scale, everybody understands, because it is little bit related to the day-to-day experiences, like in the room area, if you take length into width, length can be some 50 feet, that we easily see and understand. But quantum scale, you cannot see, because it is too small, very, very small scale, that we will not be able to see the scale, but we can see its effects. We can measure it in the laboratory. For example, we can measure the electron mass, we can measure the proton mass. That can be measured through indirect means in the laboratory. So the word quantum, anything that is related to the nanoscale level, we call it as quantum. Now, coming to, this is the simplest meaning I'm taking now, but gradually as we progress, we'll take it, enter into some difficult things. Now, what is consciousness? Consciousness is related to, simple meaning we'll take in the beginning of this lecture series. Consciousness is simple awareness. Anything that you know something is existing, as long as you see with your senses. That awareness, that chetana, what you get inside the body-mind frame, that is called consciousness. Consciousness is basically awareness. For example, when you are sleeping in the night, you are not aware of your body, neither you are aware of your mind. What does it mean? When you are sleeping, what happens to the consciousness? Where it goes? Whether it merges with cosmic nature, or it merges with gods, or where does it go? Because you are like a dead body. So consciousness, let us take it based on our experiences and the dictionary meanings, what they give, it is awareness. So this awareness exists at the quantum scale level, that is inside one of observer's mind. When we meditate, we are always aware of your own self, that is inside world. And there is outside world. Outside world is cosmic nature which you see. Now to illustrate what is subjective quantum scale and what is objective classical scale. Now to illustrate the subjective awareness, that is quantum consciousness, in our Puranas, there is a beautiful story that has been linked to quantum consciousness and classical consciousness. The very first slide, what I am showing here, it illustrates the subjective world, that is quantum consciousness, and the objective world, that is classical consciousness, through this or Puranic story. Everybody must be knowing about this story. The picture itself is self-indicative, but still I will briefly tell this story so that you people will be able to understand the quantum consciousness and the classical consciousness. Once in the Shivaloka, in the mountains region, Shiva and Parvati were relaxing with his family members, that is Ganesha and Kartikeyan and Ganesha, they were relaxing. At that time, Narada Maharshi enters into the abode of Shiva's family. There, when he sees, he's relaxing nicely. You know how Narada creates the problems because he is a messenger also. Narada, he had one fruit in his hand. So he takes the fruit and gives to Shiva and Parvati to give it to their sons. They were in dilemma. There are two sons, one fruit, and we cannot cut it because it should not be cut. That is the condition. Then what Shiva and Parvati, they decide, okay, let us have the game, competition. Whoever wins the competition, they will get this fruit. Now, the competition is whoever moves around the universe and comes first and comes back, they will be given this, he will be given this fruit. The moment Shiva uttered these words, Kartikeyan, what he did, he took his vehicle, that is peacock, he takes the vehicle and immediately jumps on it and he starts moving around the world to cover the universe. But you know how Ganesha behaves. Ganesha, he never bothered about anything. He simply takes one round of his parents, then comes back and he takes the fruit. Because Kartikeyan, after some time, he comes back and he sees that Ganesh is already having the fruit. Then he felt very angry. How Ganesha, who was staying here itself, how he got the fruit? Then they explained, no, he took the round of the parents, because parents themselves are the universe and nothing greater than the parents. So he just took a round and he took the fruit. Then he was not convinced. Who? Kartikeyan was not convinced. I covered all the distance, like the present day scientists. I covered such a long distance moving around the world and I came back and you have done the injustice. Then Ganesha says, you take the fruit, I don't have anything, but there is a reason for my taking the fruit. Inside me, the mind that thinks. So mind, it told me that you just take the round and the parents themselves are the universe. Nothing greater than the parents. Shiva and Parvati, they are the creators. They are the sustainers. They are everything. So that is my justification in covering the parents with a round. Then Kartikeyan didn't budge. Okay, this story goes like that. But what is the significance of this story to quantum consciousness? The path that is covered by Kartikeyan, it is called longest path, that is called string theory in quantum physics. I will later, little bit as we go on, I will explain what is string theory in quantum physics. That is a very much important concept in quantum physics. Then the Ganesha's approach, Ganesha's method, what you followed the journey, it is called quantum loop gravity. The subjective world is quantum loop gravity. The objective world is string theory. String, you know, it is a something like rope, like a big thread covering the long distances, covering all the planets, stars, everything. Why I illustrated this story? Because this story covers the subjective and objective world, and the present day human beings are enjoying both. So far, objective world only we were believing, but off late in the artificial intelligence era, people started believing the soul. How the artificial intelligence smart devices were developed. These smart devices are all based on the subjective science, that is quantum consciousness. I will illustrate what is this, how many models are there for quantum consciousness. There are nearly 100 quantum models are available to explain the quantum consciousness. Here in this slide, which I am showing, it has covered nearly some 50-70 slides, 50-70 models. And in these all 50-70 models, the every model, it will take 1 hour, 2 hour lecture. I will not go into the details of these models. But I will cover some important models which we come across in our quantum consciousness concept. Those models I have put a red mark in the slide. These models are very important to know, to understand the quantum consciousness. And if you people feel, given nearly some 70 models, because I will be skipping some of these models because of the time shortage. But basic concepts in quantum physics, I will be covering. Now I will start with the experimental thing. In 1870, the first time Young, by a physicist named by Young, he conducted an experiment called double slit experiment. In 1860 he started, and 1870 his paper was published. what is this double slit is all about? What is this experiment? How it is related to quantum physics in during the 19th century? He made the experiment and he could prove something. What is that experiment we are going to talk, and what is the relevance of this experiment in the present day artificial intelligence era? Before getting into double slit experiment, that is one model I am taking now, is because it is experiment conducted by him. Before going into that, I will little bit cover what is the characteristic of the electron, proton or quarks or whatever the particle we are talking about. It is said in quantum physics, an electron will both behave as a particle and also as a wave. Now a little bit very dual behavior in our philosophy, we call it a dualistic approach. What is this particle and wave? To illustrate this particular nature, the behavior of the elementary particles, Schrodinger, I don't know whether you people have heard, Schrodinger is another great quantum physicist who discovered Schrodinger equation. His analogy, his illustration is related to cat, Billy. So what he did, he imaginary experiment he conducted. What he said, you imagine a cat. You have put the cat inside the box, inside the cardboard box where cat is put inside. You can see in this slide, cat is there with his eyes wide open. Now the observer is outside the box, like me or like the students, they are outside the box. In the observer's mind, he was thinking two things. He was thinking either cat must be alive or cat must be dead. Either of these two things, one is certain, it is either dead or alive, but two things are taking place. Cat is dead, cat is alive. It is both. So what he says, they are Schrodinger, the observer's mind, there is a chance, 50% probability that cat is alive, 50% chances cat is dead. So mind is thinking in both ways, both as particle and also as a wave. Cat is alive, cat is dead. These two probability theories have been put in Schrodinger's equation, wave equation it is called. In that wave equation, you analyze this particular imaginary experiment and it solves that equation. The Schrodinger's cat in quantum physics, if you refer, always Schrodinger's cat is quoted because it is both a wave and particle. All the elementary particles, what you see in the periodic in the particle theory, all these particles have the behavior. Sometimes it behaves like a particle, sometimes it behaves like a wave. Now I'll come back with this illustration of Schrodinger. I'll come back to double slit experiment slide. See, this is double slit experiment conducted by Young, the quantum physicist. You can see in the picture, electrons are produced out of photons. Photons are bombarded and it is split into, you know what is photon? Do you want me to explain what is photon or everybody understands? Narendra? Narendra?
Just say one line and you can go ahead on photon. No need to explain more.
Okay. You know photons are emitted by sun. It is an energy particle without any charges. Whereas electron protons have charges, photons doesn't have. It is used just as an energy. Now that energy photons, it is passed through a slit. And that slit you can see in the picture, it is, you can see some wave-like patterns in the first slit. It is shown on the left side also, and it is also shown as particles. And it is very clear in a double slit. In double slit experiment, the pattern of the waves, which is going round about in the rectangular thing, you can see that. So through this experiment in the 19th century, he has proved that electron will behave both as a particle and wave, which we have illustrated through the CAT experiment, and we are illustrating through the experimental observation that was found by the young scientist. Now, once this is explained, you will go to the model. So using this wave theory, David Bohm, what he considered, he divided the brain into two parts. One is called matter wave and another is quantum wave. Matter waves is like classical physics of Newton's, and wave theory is based on the Schrodinger's wave equation. Now he says it always the elementary particles, which you have electrons, protons, quarks and all that, it is all there in the atom. And from atom it goes to molecule, and from molecule in every human being we have molecules, that is in the form of the protein. And these proteins themselves organically it forms into conscious human beings. You can see in the picture, the brain is depicted in terms of the conscious human being. And this was the first quantum model, David Bohm's, which gained a lot of popularity during that time. Then there are many models, as I told you. Now, some of the models, I tried to put it in this picture, where you can see the different models. Then there is a model in all the living things where quantum biology is involved. Because the moment I talk about the brain, mind, biology comes into the picture, neuroscience also it comes into the picture. We are all familiar with photosynthesis. Photosynthesis, how the plants manufacture its energy from the sunlight. That is photons, that is shown here, that is quantum biology. how the respiration, we take oxygen inside, what happens to the oxygen molecules inside the body, that is also quantum biology. And now the present DNA, RNA science, now everybody is familiar with the RNA molecules, PTRC tests, all this is related to the RNA molecule. So all this is quantum biology only will explain. That's why quantum concept is very important to explain all this phenomena which is taking place and we are seeing in our day-to-day life. And this is the quantum biology of the consciousness. And there are some more models available in the literature. I have given some of these models here. One can, whoever wants to go further deep in the quantum models to explain the quantum consciousness, one can refer these research papers. Now, as I told you in the very beginning itself, there exist two theories, string theory and quantum loop gravity. The Karthikeyan's method of going around the world, covering the universe, it is related to the string theory. String means thread or rope. You imagine the rope going into the longest distance of this cosmos, covering all the planets, stars, everything. Longest distance, it goes up to some billions of kilometers. Now this so much big distance, it is always represented by a wave. If you look at the longest wavelength in the string theory, it is that the longest distance coverage is called string theory. String, you all understand. And in Puranas, in our Indian culture also, there are many stories which illustrates about the string theory. To measure the height of the Lord Vishnu, they go from the top and the bottom also. Why Brahma doesn't have the temple in the planet? It is, this story is illustrated in that. And they never find the beginning and end of the universe. So string theory is related to that Puranic story. Now what is quantum loop gravity? You all know about the Newton's theory, how the apple falls on the ground. It is all due to gravitation. People are thinking there is a big magnet which exists inside the earth, and that is making everybody to fall down to the earth. And that was the theory of Newton's. Now, to understand the string theory and the gravity, that is quantum loop gravity. Quantum loop gravity is subject to science, string theory is object to science. I mean, to illustrate and make you to understand what are these theories all about. Quantum loop gravity, it is based on the Albert Einstein's theory of relativity. Narendra, you want me to cover this Einstein's theory?
Little bit, Paranji, if you can cover, that will be great, little bit.
Yeah, okay. See, Einstein's theory of relativity, it has two laws. One is special theory of relativity and general theory of relativity. Special theory of relativity is, you are able to listen. Now, I'm able to communicate because somebody is listening. You are able to sit, I am able to stand, because it is all relative. You can say a train is moving fast. train is moving fast, you can say only somebody's resting train should be there. So the it is not absolute position, it is always relative position. And using this theory, you proved that E equal to mc square. Everything is deterministic. And E equal to mc square, energy equal to mass into square of the speed of the light. That is E equal to mc square. You know the significance of this relation. Now suppose I am there, my weight is around 70 kilos or 60 kilos. Can you ever at any given point of time convert your mass into energy? Can you ever imagine? Can anybody imagine?
No, cannot imagine.
Suppose now I am 70 kilos. Now I will see that it will be converted into energy. Suppose if you are going in the motorbike at 50 kilometers per hour, then nothing will be happening. And it is a common, everybody travels in a motorbike, 50 kilometers is a tolerable. I will make you to travel at 100 kilometers. Then what will happen slightly when you start moving at high speed in the motorbike, you will start feeling your shirt is flutting, and then wind is blowing, all that sensations you will get. Suppose if I make you to go at 500 kilometer speed, then what will happen to you? Or 1000 kilometers per hour? You can't imagine, you will become uncomfortable and all your body consciousness will get off. It will be only at the mental level only you will be able to drive the vehicle. Because body is not, will not be cooperating. Now imagine I'll be making you to travel at 100 crore kilometers per hour. Then you are no more, I am no more Paran or no more Naren or no more any of the students. Because all your 70 kilos of weight gets converted into energy because you are traveling with the speed of the light. Speed of the light, it is 10 to the power of 9 centimeters per second. So that is the speed of the light. So when somebody travels with the speed of the light, you exist with no more physical appearance of 70 kilos, you are nothing but a particle with no identity, nothing. And how much energy you got converted? Then the relation comes here, E equal to mc square. M is equal to 70 kilos. Speed of the light is constant. You calculate the energy. That means this is the energy that the electrons or any fundamental particles will possess. And this relation was proved 101 times in the laboratory. That's why when atom bomb is dropped, a single atom bomb of less than 1 gram, it will explode into tons of energy. And that destroys the world. And if you use it peacefully, you can use it as electricity. So that is the energy which is governed at the atomic scale. It has tremendous potential. This type of atomic explosion you cannot explain with the classical physics. And that's why we use quantum physics. And consciousness is nothing but the elementary particles. It has hundreds of quarks. It is not stable. It just appear, disappear like particle and wave. And it produces enormous amounts of energy. And that energy gets channelized through the neurons. And that energy, how we calculate, it is through E equal to mc square. That is about the, whenever somebody talks about Einstein's relativity theory is used, it is a special theory equal to E equal to mc square. Second theory is about the gravity, gravitational force. Suppose if you imagine rain is falling, when rain falls on the ground, what will happen to the rain? Drops water? What will happen to the rainwater?
It will get dispersed.
So it will search for the lower portion and water will start flowing towards the lower portion.
Yeah.
So that is called curvature. In physics, wherever the lower curvatures are there, wherever the pit is there, water starts falling on that. So Einstein never uses magnet or anything. He says curvature, space theory uses up and downs on the surface. That curvature theory of the water falls is not because of the magnet or anything, because it is at lower curvature, it is a bending of the space towards the lower side. That's why water goes there. And this theory of curvature is Einstein's general theory of relativity. And he says the gravity is nothing but a space curvature. And this space curvature, wherever lower side it comes, the water automatically falls. Like this curvature, space curvature, it bends. Using this space curvature theory, he has established a relation for the gravitational force which holds the atom elements together. And this gravitational force is such a strong force, it is such a weak force, it is very difficult to discover. See, all forces, electromagnetic theory, strong nuclear forces, then the electrical, then this electric magnetic, then the strong nuclear forces, and the weak force is this gravitational force. And the gravitational force that holds the particles together very weakly. Suppose one particle exists, proton here, somewhere in the other cosmic universe it will exist another particle. So the linking is the gravitational force. Even now people are doing a lot of experiments in this theory. Whatever Ganesha in that story illustrated, he made the particles to move, his mind start thinking in the one location itself, and within no time he covered the entire universe. That is the consciousness nature. And the quantum loop theory, it explains about the quantum consciousness. How quantum consciousness, using these two theories, one is the longest wave and another is the shortest wave in quantum physics. These two theories differ, but it can explain the concept of consciousness. Is it okay, Narendra? Shall I continue or?
Yes, yes, please continue. It is going very well. Please continue. It is going very nicely. Yeah.
Okay, now let us get into the now I will relate the artificial intelligence and some more quantum models, how this can be used in explaining the quantum consciousness. So all this we have covered. Now let us get into quantum loop theory is over. And you will also come across Bohr's B-O-H-R. He was an atomic scientist who laid the rules. Atom contains what? Nucleus and electrons. Atom, it has a nucleus, which is proton and neutrons. We always call it is the smallest particle in the atom. It is not like that. Now they have discovered quark particles. Quark particles that makes up the individual protons or electrons. So quarks, it is again subdivided into six smaller particles. That's called positive electrons, negative electrons, all that six quarks. The discovery of these particles are available. You know how you discover the particles in the laboratory? These particles can be easily discovered based on their tracks. Suppose proton is there, positive proton, it will go in the upward direction. And the negative electron, it goes downward direction. So based on the direction, we can say this is electron, because nobody has seen the proton or electron in the laboratory. Nobody has seen, but we are talking about the protons, we are talking about the quarks, we are talking about the electrons. This is very simple counter is there, GM, Geiger-Müller counter. The particles are allowed to pass through. If it is proton, it will go in the upward direction. If it is an electron, it will go in the downward direction. So based on the tracks of the particles, one can say it is electron or proton. And once they get the track of the particle, they will measure the mass, because we can't measure the mass like our usual marketplaces where we use the physical balance. We don't use that. But based on the tracks, one can see the density of the particles. Once you know the density of the particle, then mass by volume, you always take the per unit volume, then mass of the electron can be easily calculated. This is how they determine the mass of the fundamental particles, which is constant in the universe. That's what we have mentioned also, that how these quark particles can explain the different aspects of the nature. But one unique feature of these quark particles, it will not leave the other particles so easily. It is always interconnected, interrelated, and interdependent. Quarks can never be separated. It has its own quantum numbers. You understand the quantum numbers, no?
Yes.
Like spin quantum numbers, we always, that's what Bohr theory about the atomic structure is all about, how electrons would behave. If two electrons cannot coexist together in the same orbit, it has a different charged particles, it has to be plus and minus, then only they can live together. Like you can compare male and female. Male and female only can live for a long time in the universe. Like that, in the microscopic scale, it is called the spin quantum numbers. Spin, if electron is plus, then the another electron with the minus sign only, it can exist in the same orbit. That is the rule. It is called Pauli's exclusion principle in the atomic structure. That can be studied also if somebody is interested. But just broadly, if somebody comes across the Pauli's principle, that means no male-male can exist, but male-female can exist in one family. Like in the orbit, only the plus and minus particles can exist. That is called Pauli's principle. Now, as I told you, the quark particles, it cannot be separated. It always exists together. Just in a nanosecond, it will disappear into plus, and it will nanoseconds, it will convert back into minus. So that is the nature. It is all interconnected, highly interrelated particles. I'll show you one picture, then how it is interrelated and interconnected, then you will be able to appreciate. See this picture, how human being is like a spider's web, no? He is like, he is got embedded in this. He cannot go out. Suppose if you now imagine how the interconnectedness, it affects the universe. Suppose if petrol price in Gulf is very high, then in India it will become double price. That means somewhere in the universe some action is taking place, but here we are affected. That means we are interconnected, I mean at gross scale. Like that, at the microscopic scale also, we are interconnected, interdependent, and interrelated. This is well illustrated. All brain neurons, you know, if you have seen the brain neurons, it is so interconnected and interdependent. One neuron cannot exist without another neurons in the brain. It's all interconnected. This particular interconnectedness, interrelatedness, it has been mentioned in our Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. It is our great cultural textbook, Indian cultural textbook. It was mentioned in that Upanishad that what is that Narendra, that what is the name of that Rishi Yajnavalkya.
Yajnavalkya and Maitri, Gargi.
Correct. So that Yajnavalkya and Maitri, there was a great debate between these two people. He has fulfilled all the knowledge, you know, they used to, without any gender issue, they were used to discuss and sort out the problems. So once, for a higher attainment of spirituality, enlightenment, Yajnavalkya thought that he can go to jungles and do meditation. Then Yajnavalkya, when he was about to leave, then she comes, Maitreyi, and tells him, "You cannot leave me alone. You have to take me also along with you to the forest." Then he says, "I have given you everything. I have given you the cows. I have given you the wealth. I have given you the shelter. I have given you the, everything. I have given whatever you ask for." Then Maitreyi says, "You are not given one thing. I am also a partner in the knowledge which you have to share. I am also interconnected to you. You cannot just leave me. We are knowledge partners also. As long as you live, you have to, I have to be with you. We are all interconnected." Like that, a great debate goes on, that the concept of interconnectedness, interrelatedness, it is mentioned very elaborately in our Indian cultural textbook and Upanishad, that is Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. How this interconnectedness is further explained, I'll show you another picture. Yeah, this picture also I will explain a little bit. This interconnectedness, interrelatedness, and interpenetratedness, how it is related to that, the particle level, at the brain level, at the quantum consciousness level. As I told you, the quarks are highly interrelated and interdependent. Now I am sitting here. How I am able to connect with Dr. Narendra ji? Can anybody guess? At the quantum level, I am asking. How my consciousness level, how my communication, it is reaching Narendra ji?
Somewhere the subtler than the mind, some connections are there. Our minds are somewhere, souls are connected, our minds are connected. It is not just internet connection, it is also somewhere, you can say, soul connection.
I'll put the same words, whatever it said, at the quantum level.
Okay.
Now you see in the picture, battery is what? The battery. Thank you. I will little bit explain about how we are interconnected. As I told you, it was from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, but how in quantum physics it is related. Now Narendra ji is sitting in Mumbai, I am sitting in Haridwar, but we are still how the communication is taking place. As I told you, in the computer language, you know, whatever I talk, it is converted into machine language. What is machine language? Machine language is very simple. It is a digital numbers of 01. Because when we were in IIT Mumbai, we used to convert the English language into machine language. Machine language means 01 code. Suppose if one letter is there, A, we assign it as a code, and B is there, one code. Then again, whenever A comes, we use again 0. Like that, 01, 01, 001, 11, like that, it repeats by itself. That's what you see in the picture. This is how we are connected at the quantum level, because it travels with high speeds, and that's why we are able to communicate. And all fundamental particles, all quarks, electrons, everything, it is all related to this, because computer doesn't know which is electron or proton, but computer knows 01 code. That's why you can see the 01 code in the, this is, you can say, the bigger one is Narendra. This is the spin quantum numbers of Narendra, and this is the spin quantum numbers of Param. All that communication, it is converted into machine language, that is 01 code. You can see the 01 code getting attracted to the, passing to the Param's brain. This is called machine language, the 01 which you see. And this in quantum physics, we call it as entanglement. Suppose if I put on the light here, immediately light glows there in the Mumbai. This is the sensor technology we use in mobiles. We use in everything, day-to-day life, sensors have become so powerful. 01 coding system is so powerful that we are using it in the artificial intelligence. Everywhere we are using this particular entanglement theory, which was said, quantum entanglement, very elaborately in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. The concept is very well mentioned there. And you see this orbit, entanglement orbit. You can see that in the picture. Now, I will a little bit explain how this information, biologically, what is happening in the brain neurons. You know, basically, when a particle interacts at the neuron level, it all gets converted into ions. You know, ion is nothing but a charged particle which is flowing inside the neurons, inside the, like I showed in the picture, you see. In the picture, you can see how the channels are flowing. This is how the information sharing is taking place inside the neurons. This neuron channels, in the neuron channels, this ionic currents flows in the neuron channels of the brain. And you know, anion, cation, all these ions, it flows at the micro, the quantum level in the conscious levels of the, this itself is a consciousness. what is consciousness? It is basically the flow of the different types of ions in the brain, and that ions itself is a biology of the living things. Whereas in the crystals, it is same potassium, calcium, all ions are there, but there is no life in that. There is no, it is a non-living thing. But in the brain, it is a living thing. How it is in the brain, it is a living thing. It is explained in our scriptures. This I'll show you. You will be able to appreciate this picture. What is happening in the quantum consciousness, how it happens in inside our human being. Inside the human being, you all must be aware of chakras inside the body. There's the seven chakras, predominant chakras, Vishuddha chakra, Muladhara chakra, Sahasrara chakra, like that. There are different chakras. What are these chakras equivalent to in quantum consciousness? It is very simple. All these chakras can be related to the spin quantum numbers of the quark particles. The different quark particles will have different spin quantum numbers. That is called chakra. So all these chakras are related to spin quantum numbers in quantum physics. And this spin quantum numbers to make people very difficult to understand. And this spin quantum number, chakra and all this very difficult. So what they have done, our Indian astrologists, they are related to rasis. You can see the rasis here. Dhanu Rasi, the Megha Rasi, Scorpion, all these rasis one can see. And this is, these people understand because they can see, you know, all these animals. But chakras they can't see. But they have made equivalent of that so that ordinary man can understand these chakras and the spin quantum numbers, which we have elaborately mentioned. This is the right hand side picture. And left hand side, one can see how human being consciousness, it is pervaded in the universe. This particular picture, what you see, it is called universal consciousness. Because after all, we are part of the universe. Now, the all the scientists, including the artificial intelligence scientists, they have accepted man is not only the body-mind. Body-mind is related to non-local situation in the cosmic space. Local means body mind, non-local means outside the body mind. That means cosmic space. And that's how this illustration, this picture is shown. But I'll show you much more better picture, then you'll be able to appreciate. Now, how man is linked? We say Vasudeva Kutumbakam. We are part of that Kutumbakam. We are part of that family, universal family. In the language of quantum physics, it is called universal consciousness. How individual consciousness is related to the universal consciousness? This picture you'll be able to explain how your consciousness, your soul, your mind, your Atma is related to the Paramatman. How it is related to the universe, how you are interconnected. The central picture, what you see, this is universal consciousness. And the side things, what you see, it is individual consciousness we are trying to get in tune with the universal consciousness, and that's what this picture you can see here. inside the picture, one finger is touching the cosmic finger. That means your individual consciousness is passing, that is electric current only, it is passing to the cosmic consciousness. Vasudeva Kutumbakam concept has come here at the consciousness level. Here also same thing, how human being, his brain is related to the cosmic energy. And all these molecules, RNA, DNA, and how human being, right from the birth, you must have heard the story of Abhimanyu. While he was in the womb of the mother, you could hear the voice of the Lord Krishna. In the same way, the child is there in the mother's womb and is related to the cosmic consciousness, universal soul. That's how he is related to the universal consciousness. And the day is not far. How a human being is going to observe the consciousness, that is very easy. I'll show you another slide, then you will be able to appreciate. Yeah. See, now the tomorrow's artificial intelligence technology, a robot is going to hold the brain neurons in its hand, because we can't do surgery to the brain because neuron connection will be disrupted. But tomorrow's technology is going to be the robot. A robot will hold the brain neurons and it will find the consciousness pattern. That consciousness pattern you can see here in the picture. So already in quantum physics, the patterns have become very important phenomena in the physics. Through the patterns, one can judge the behavior of another person, which is psychology. Now the pattern what you see here around the brain, this will be different pattern if it is Narendraji's or it is Anjali or Archana or Richika. These are our students. So you can see different patterns. Based on the patterns, one can see the psychological behavior can be studied very easily. And these patterns, one can do the programming, and one can use the artificial intelligence Python program and make the patterns and judge the behavior of a person. The traditional method of using the questionnaires and all that in psychology will not be there. That will be replaced by pattern consciousness approach. Based on this, this robot only can read because it converts into machine language and studies the behavior of the person. And that is what it is given in this particular picture. Now, how it is possible only two robots, that I will show you. See, now for example, what you see on the board, like wave pattern, geometry, quantum chemistry, quantum physics, everything you can see on the board. This will take one's own lifetime to understand this. But robot will be able to solve all this within seconds. And consciousness has to be studied from that pattern way, and only robots can do that. And already robots are performing using the artificial intelligence program. It is doing all these studies. That's why this picture, within no seconds, it will convert. And our rishis have done great experiments, great field level. You can see how the human consciousness and transcendental experiences like Aurobindo's. I'll come to the Aurobindo, then we'll be able to appreciate. this is the relation between the individual consciousness and the universal consciousness. One can see the globe here and how man is meditating at the top level. See, Aurobindo's philosophy of integral yoga, how it is related to quantum consciousness. What is the other name for integral yoga can be supramental consciousness. Am I right, Narendra?
Yes.
So the other name for integral yoga, it is supramental.
You can also mention Swamiji. Swami Vivekananda also you can mention.
Yeah, Swami Vivekananda's consciousness also one can consider in this particular thing. This integral yoga or Raja Yoga of Swami Vivekananda. Raja Yoga, Vivekananda never talks of integral yoga, but he talks of Raja Yoga. One can attain that the difference between them. So Aurobindo's concept of supramental consciousness. Supramental in the entire Pondicherry is meditation technique. Even if you go to Pondicherry and see Mother's, that holy place, you can see that, you can feel the supramental vibrations. And the method to see the supramental consciousness, one has to have the integral yoga practices. That means joining your individual mind, individual consciousness to supramental state. That is Aurobindo's. Languages are different, but the goal is same. And David Bohm's theory also cannot be separated from the matter. Body is important to know the mind. Without body, you can't understand the mind. From ordinary life, converting ordinary life into divine life, life divine in Aurobindo's language, or in the quantum, it is evolution process. From man to become an angel, what we call in our Puranic stories. The same concept is calling life divine. It's an evolutionary process. Unlike Darwin's theory, it uses very biological things and it is very, what you can say, it is limited to monkeys. But Aurobindo's theory of evolution is a biological evolution from a man state to supramental state, that is Aurobindo's, comparing to Darwin's theory. In quantum language, this evolution, one can say, see, man is defined, the body and mind, in three-dimensional space. Suppose if I talk in the language of quantum consciousness, it will become five-dimensional space. I don't know whether you are able to get the feeling of this different dimensions. Now, I am living in the dimension of Haridwar. This is one dimension. Yeah, Narendraji is living in Mumbai. That is another dimension of life. Like that, the human consciousness can also live in different dimensions. There is a fourth dimension. Paramatman is in the fifth dimension, that is life divine, which I mentioned, man into a superman. To enter into that state, we have to enter into fifth dimension. In the discussion, one can use this Aurobindo's philosophy with respect to superman or supramental state, that is the fifth dimension in quantum language. And the methodology is integral yoga practices. Narendra ji?
Summary kar sakte hai, sir. Concluding karke main, I will offer vote of thanks. I'll just take that. Yeah. Just one question. Can we take one question? You summarize, then I will just take one question.
So now, how the quantum consciousness is different from the classical consciousness that has been covered using the different models of quantum physics on brain. There are nearly 100 models available to explain the quantum consciousness. All 100 models cannot be covered, but whoever is interested, one can cover that particular quantum consciousness. But all these models will be helpful to understand the consciousness. And also with the philosophies of the Aurobindo, Sri Aurobindo and Vivekananda's, one can relate our Indian culture, our Indian philosophy with these latest findings. And that's how I ended with Sri Aurobindo's philosophy from life divine or from the ordinary state of mind evolution going into supramental state of evolution. And that is the work of this conscious behavior, and that is the work of the integral yoga of Aurobindo's. One has to practically experience these things like our disease, then one will be able to get into the scientific aspects of the brain behavior psychology. This is what I tried to cover. Yes, Narendraji, now you can take over.
One or two just quick questions. Paranji, thank you so much for your enlightening talk. Thank you so much for making it so understandable for all the people. One or two questions are there. One is about the Roger Penrose. He has, you know, written a book, Shadows of the Mind, and also other people who are trying to tackle it from mathematics, and then trying to tell that there is some connection with the fractals. The world is having full of fractals or Mandelbrot series, and that is one question. Is there any that type of repeating pattern, recursive pattern in the entire universe, that from small to big same thing happens? That is one question. And second question is, there is something called as from neuron to neuron, when it is going, there is some sort of uncertainty there, means there is some quantum jump it has to take. So is it true? So these two questions are there.
I not covered that uncertainty principle. In quantum physics, it is called Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. This Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, if you have seen in the double slit experiment carefully, the moment particle, the wave turns into a particle, there is a shift in the position and momentum of the particle. That uncertainty in the position and momentum of the particle is called Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Suppose if you want to see the electron in the laboratory through electron microscope, the moment you observe the electron in the microscope, it is no more in that position. It has shifted to some other position. Particle has become a wave. That is the uncertainty we have. That is called, in the language of mathematics, I will use a little bit mathematics, position into momentum is equal to, roughly equal to, Planck's constant, that is 10 to the power of minus 19. This is called uncertainty principle of Heisenberg. That is about the uncertainty. With regard to the Penrose model, see, what the biggest mistake what Penrose has done, he assumed consciousness is inversely proportional to the time. Within some 10 to the power of minus seconds, one can the wave will collapse, like we see in the crystals. He has compared the consciousness with the crystals. That is a protein molecule. He has taken a protein molecule. What is that protein molecule inside the brain? It is called, I have forgotten the name. That protein molecules, he measures the dimensions of the consciousness. That is the mistake, that is the blunder Penrose has committed. With the result, the Penrose model has been taken off, and it has been interpreted. Consciousness cannot be an objective thing. What Penrose has done, he has converted into objective thing. that is the Penrose blender, because he was having the supercomputers of the in the UK, quantum computers, what you call. So using the consciousness, he has approximated and tried to use the wave collapse theory and put it in an objective like a germanium crystal or any crystal. So there he has failed, and that theory was modified further into a pattern theory, which at present 2014, Penrose theory has been interpreted in differently. But he has laid a good foundation for further studies. And similarly, the fractals also.
So what is the new theory which has replaced Parinji?
Pattern behavior, no? Using artificial intelligence.
By whom it is?
We cannot put it into, still it, the research is going on. It is in 2016, the very latest only. Like I showed you, no, using the robot holding the consciousness pattern. That is the latest theory of the consciousness, that we have to see the chronology and say, not one individual, you can say, because experimentally they found different patterns. Suppose if a man is lying, then the patterns they observed in that man who is lie detector test in criminology, no? They observe the patterns only now and judge the behavior of a person. And that uses the quantum consciousness.
Okay, thank you so much. Let me thank you for your valuable time and very powerful and very yet very simplified way of narrating it. We look forward to your guidance and more such speeches to enlighten all the people who are interested in this very wonderful subject of connecting quantum consciousness and also our ancient Indian scriptures. And Brahadaranyaka Upanishad also you connected with that, and Sri Aurobindo and Swami Vivekananda's teaching. So thank you so much for this very motivating talk, Paranji. Namaste. I again thank on behalf of all of us at Mumbai here. I want to offer my sincere thanks to you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Paranji.
Thank you. No problem. We are here to assist each other. Thank you.
And just 1 minute, Paranji, just 1 minute, since we have got this opportunity, I just want to take this opportunity.